Get the mic from you.
If you just get the dollars, we'll put front wheels up on it.
Right, go fight win. No, that's not right. Wrong event. Sorry. Go fight win, is it?
You need a haircut.
I know. But I can't drive. And try to get five people to take me anywhere. Four people.
What are you, like an invalid or something like that? What?
Well, it's my right leg. So,
I know
you don't. There's no empathy there. I understand. I just get in the car and drive.
Holy crap! You got a brand new knee. Why would I be? You know.
Well, yeah, I didn't want it spasming. Spasms, and now I'm going through a wall.
Is it doing pretty good? Like,
now it is. Now it is. It's doing a lot better now. Oh, we'll see today.
The pain's not as bad.
Not as bad. I know. Not as bad. Yeah.
You know what? I can. Where's the spasm coming from? It's a topic, and there's no.
Well, I think it's new muscles. I think I walked bow-legged.
This thing's kind of
regenerating. I was like this for 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
So I'm now 6'8", so I feel a lot better.
Back up where you need to be, right? I must be 6'8", too, John. I think we're about 6'8".
Well, honestly, my x-rays, you should see that just bow-legged. Because those knees start
to Yeah. Do you have
they support? Have to straighten them like an alignment, Steve. Now, if you have to align it, Steve, with some part of your shoulder, it's got to be straight. You got to get it right.
You probably did get a little taller.
Oh, yeah.
But I'm not sure if I'm looking up to you yet or not.
Does he wear all of his shoes out on the outside? Or...
Give me the benefit of the doubt, will you? Right. Tell him, give me the benefit of the doubt. Round it up to the next dish.
welcome to anybody who's a visitor this morning or our guest. We're so glad you've chosen to worship with us. Pray and trust as you do that, you'll be drawn closer to us as a church family, church, and a community of faith. And it's so good to see so many of you back with us worshiping. I have to announce that Women's Ministry, after next Sunday service, will have a meeting in the fellowship hall. So that's all the announcements I'm going to make. But I do want to say, would all our moms please stand up? Anybody who's a mother, please stand up. Let's give it up to them. That's right, and we're going to be Catholics for a second here. Let's all stand again. For our call to worship.
No secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us take a brief moment and ask the Holy Spirit to show us where we fall short of God's standard of holiness, confess those sins, and receive the forgiveness that we have in the shed blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
This is a new song. It's pretty easy to get the groove on it. We just learned it this morning, so be patient, please.
In the morning, hotel walks with the rain. lost our way from home. Our Father finds the child inside. We left for growing old. Awake, 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 my soul. So still comes in the morning. We still walks with the herd. You're still alive and free. Praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. Still good news worth repeating. So lift your head.
Loves the Father, loves his child as well. This is how we know that we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. In fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands. And his commands are not burdensome. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And the three are in agreement. Here ends our first reading. And our gospel reading is from John chapter 15, verses 9 through 17. Hear the word of the Lord. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I've called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other.
The gospel.
Praise to you, Christ.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, O Christ.
Johnny, she said, do you pray before meals? And Johnny replied, no, ma'am, I don't have to. My mom's a good cook. But moms do say some confusing things at times, like, I'm warning you, son, if you fall out of that tree and break both legs, don't come running to me. How can you run it on him? And there's some things mothers would never, ever say. One is, how can on earth can you see the TV sitting that far back? Or how about this one? Just leave all the lights on. It makes the house look a bit more cheery. Or go ahead and keep that stray dog, honey. I'll be glad to feed and walk him every day. And the curfew is just a general time to shoot for. It's not like I'm running a prison around here. Well, we know moms. They're wonderful. And comedian Jeff Foxworthy tells us that moms will clean up everything. In fact, he said scientists have proven that a mom's spittle is the exact chemical composition of Formula 409. So that moms spit on a Kleenex, you can get rust off a bumper with that stuff. And everybody wants to save the earth, but nobody wants to help mom do the dishes, do they? And I love this one, and bear with me, guys. It's never easy being a mother. If it were easy, fathers would do it. Teddy's clapping. Anybody want to experience joy this Mother's Day? I would hope we do. Hopefully you'll experience joy from being a mother or honoring your mother. Mother's Day can be hard, be a hard one, particularly if your mother is no longer here. My sister reminded me the other day that our mother died on May 1st, 2010, exactly 10 days after Lexi was born. My mom had lung cancer. It went to her brain, and she was still cognizant of things, a little bit aware, and she knew Lexi was coming. And when Lexi was born, I called her that afternoon and got her on the phone through a nurse. And when I told her Lexi had been born, she hollered out with a very faint, woo-hoo. It was much louder when I played basketball, let me tell you, to my embarrassment at times. But mom was great, and the fact that she did that was awesome. And if she had been alive for Mackie and Gracie's birth, she would have done the same as well. I think even in her limited capacity, she experienced joy that April 23rd, 2010. And let's admit it, this last COVID-filled year and a half have not given us much joy. I'm sure there have been moments of happiness for all of us, but sheer joy, that's a different story. Even now, as we hear about all the COVID deaths in India, COVID can steal our joy. What's the difference between happiness and joy? It's real interesting. If you go to the Compassion International website, where you sponsor kids for $39 a month all over the world, it's a wonderful, wonderful ministry. They've got the difference there on their homepage between joy and happiness. And they say this, the difference between joy and happiness lives in the mind and heart. Joy is in the heart, happiness is on the face. Joy is of the soul, happiness is of the moment. Joy transcends. Happiness reacts. Joy runs deep and overflows, while happiness hugs. Hello. Joy is profound and scriptural. Don't worry, rejoice. Happiness is a bomb. Don't worry, be happy. Joy endures hardship and trials and connects with meaning and purpose. Happiness lasts for a moment. A person pursues happiness, but the Holy Spirit produces joy. And joy is a disposition of the heart that occurs when we abide in Christ and follow Him. So what gives us joy? What gives or gave our moms joy? Our gospel passage, John 15, 9 through 17. This Mom's Day tells us that Jesus wants His joy to be in us. And He wants us to experience His joy to the full, or filled to the brim, or to the max. But how do we experience the joy that He wants us to have? I want to suggest this morning that we experience the joy Jesus wants us to have the same way kids do with their moms. You say, that can't be right. After all, Jesus was a man, not a woman, or a mom. Pastor Tish Harrison Warren in her wonderful book, Prayer in the Night, says this about Jesus caring for us like a mom. Jesus wept as he sat gazing over the city of Jerusalem in Matthew 23. Through tears, he said, "How often I would have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing." Here he weeps not in rage at death of his friend Lazarus, but in the sorrow of unrequited love. It's a deeply maternal image, Harrison says. Jesus longs to gather up children, wrap them up in the safety and intimacy of his embrace, but they refuse. Any mother who's had to sit and watch her child destroy herself, watch her beloved walk into destruction, abuse, or addiction, watch as the one she sang over disappears into someone she cannot recognize, knows something about how Jesus wept over Jerusalem. I've sat with at least one mom who lost her child in her mid-30s to alcohol. Another pastor and I did her funeral. There's nothing to say to a mom who can't really understand where it all went wrong. And no pastor or counselor can either. All I could do was sit and weep with this mom whose dreams for her daughter were never realized. You see, Jesus was like a mom to the Jews. He wanted all of them and all of us to believe in him as our Messiah, our Savior, our Lord alone for our salvation. When they didn't and we don't, he wept and weeps like any mom who's lost a child. Last week, we saw that Jesus told his disciples his Father was the gardener, he was the vine, and they were the branches, and that God's purpose for them was to bear much fruit. But the only way they could do that was by remaining or abiding in the vine, who is Jesus. Specifically, he said in verses 1 through 8 that they did this through his word and prayer. As Lutherans, we know we abide also or remain in Christ through the sacraments of baptism and Holy Communion. Now here in verses 9 through 17, Jesus again tells his disciples, "I've loved you the way my Father has loved you. Make yourselves at home in my love. If you keep my commands, you'll remain intimately at home in my love. That's what I've done. Kept my Father's commands and made myself at home in his love." Now, this is the Message translation, and it's true to the text. I love the way Peterson translates the word abide with "make yourselves at home in my love." That's really what the word abide, meno, in the Greek means, to reside, to stay, to remain. So I have a question for us this morning. Have you and I made ourselves at home in his love? As I read that translation, it just overwhelmed me because I had to ask myself the same question. Have we made ourselves at home in his love? How do we do this? By keeping his commands. You'll remain intimately at home in his love. But do we even want to keep his commands? Do we care about them? Well, as believers, we should. The law is a mirror and a guide for believers, as Paul told Timothy. Even though we are not saved by the law or by keeping the law is good. It is God's will that we love him with all our hearts, mind, will, and strength, and love our neighbors as ourselves. As Paul told Titus in chapter 2, verse 11 and 12, "For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age." And don't we need to do that in this age for sure? So if we're saved by grace through faith and it is a gift from God, then why is Jesus telling us to keep his commands? Like any good parent, he wants our joy to be to the max. He doesn't want to simply make us happy. He wants us to have the full joy that he has, that he had from obeying his Father. And the only way we can do that is if we love like he has loved us. Now think about mom, your mom, for a second. How did you and she experience joy together? She had joy simply from having you as a child, nothing better. But she and you experienced that joy to the max when you listened to her voice and did what she said. Be it coming in when she called you, making your bed, taking out the trash, doing the dishes, whatever she asked you to do, if you did it, there'd be joy between you and her. And you'd experience that joy to the max. And if we didn't do what she said, just like Jesus, she would discipline us or say, wait till your father gets home. And that wasn't pleasant for many of us. The church I served in Texas, I remember old Rob. They were one of the founding families in the 1850s of that town. His mama Gladys lived to 105. I did her funeral in their dining room with a few family friends. Remember, this is Texas. After all, she outlived everybody else. Rob's brother was paralyzed from the waist down due to an auto accident on the way back to Texas Tech one night. He would lay there on a gurney, and I'd bring him communion and minister to his mom as well. What a privilege that was. Because I had no suffering compared to theirs. But old Rob was a character. He'd come to see me at the church, always with a big old chaw in his mouth. Right as he'd come into the church offices, he'd spit it out on the church parking lot, with all due respect, I think. I told him when he died, we'd get a memorial spittoon for him to put in the just outside the doors of the church. He loved his mother deeply. But he told me that when he disobeyed her, guess what she said to him? Go get a switch off the willow tree. He said, man, did that hurt. But there he was. She's 105, and she's bedridden, and he's caring for her and loved her deeply. The Lord does the same with us. We never can negate his love, for nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Neither height nor depth, angel nor demon, things present, things to come. Nothing in all creation can separate us from his love. But certainly we don't have to remain intimately in his love. We can go our own way and not abide in his love by not loving him or our neighbor, by being selfish and putting ourselves ahead of him and everyone else. And he will discipline us as Gladys did Rob. Specifically here in verse 12, he tells us, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. The love we are to have for each other is the love that the Lord Jesus Christ had for us when he died on the cross to pay for our sins, to satisfy God's wrath against our sins, so that we might have eternal life received as a gift by faith. His love is a sacrificial one. And he wants us to sacrifice our desires, needs, wants, self for the good of others, as he did for us. Think about your mom for a second. Would she have sacrificed herself for you? She did in so many little ways all the time, for sure. Teacher asked the boy a question. Suppose your mother baked a pie and there were 7 of you, your parents and 5 children. What part of the pie would you get? A 1/6, replied the boy. I'm afraid you don't know your fractions, said the teacher. Remember, there's 7 of you. Yes, teacher, said the boy, but you don't know my mom. Mom would say she didn't want any pie. Moms would also sacrifice themselves in big ways for their children, as Jesus did for us. You see, years ago, a young mother was making her way across the hills of South Wales, carrying her tiny baby in her arms. When she was overtaken by a blinding blizzard, she never reached her destination, and when the blizzard had subsided, her body was found by searchers beneath a mound of snow. But they discovered that before her death, she had taken off all her outer clothing and wrapped it about her baby. When they unwrapped the child, to their great surprise and joy, they found he was alive and well. She had mounded her body over his and given her life for the child, proving the depths of her mother love. Years later, that child, David Lloyd George, grown to manhood, became Prime Minister of Great Britain and without doubt one of England's greatest statesmen. But we know that all of us struggle to keep God's commandments. Yet John tells us in 1 John 5:3 that his commandments are not burdensome. If we are abiding in Christ, in the vine, they are not burdensome. Because as we abide, we will want to love others as Christ loves us, just as our mothers loved us. An affirmation about mothers from John Killinger's Lost in Wonder, Love, and Praise is worth hearing before I close. It goes like this. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of the loving God, who was born of the promise to a virgin named Mary. I believe in the love Mary gave her son that caused her to follow him in his ministry and stand by his cross as he died. I believe in the love of all mothers and its importance in the lives of the children they bear. It is stronger than steel, softer than down, and more resilient than a green sapling on the hillside. It closes wounds, melts disappointments, and enables the weakest child to stand tall and straight in the fields of adversity. I believe that this love, even at its best, is only a shadow of the love of God, a dark reflection of all that we can expect of Him both in this life and the next. And I believe that one of the most beautiful sights in the world is a mother who lets this greater love flow through her to her child, blessing the world with the tenderness of her touch and the tears of her joy. As we wanted to abide in our mother's love and do what she said, may we abide in our Lord's love by keeping His commandments through word and sacrament and the power of the indwelling Holy Spirit. As we abide in Him and keep His commandments, we will have joy to the max. And who doesn't want that? May we remember that God has been like a mother to us, sheltering us, feeding us, training us to be persons of integrity and faithfulness. May we thank our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for giving us earthly mothers who taught us to do the same. And all God's people said.
The first day of the rest of your life. This is the first.
I believe in God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. To judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift up our hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to His holy name, and with the saints on earth and the hosts in heaven, join in their unending hymn.
just a reflection of the love that I've been given. Everybody wants to be somebody. I want to be somebody too. If I'm gonna be known for something, I want to be known for you. Want to be the moon up among the stars, fly around the world, lighten up the dark of night. I'm nothing without the sun's amazing grace. Everything I do, if you're shining on me, I'll shine right back for you. Cover up the work you're doing in me, but still with every breath I breathe, I want to be the moon.
Body of Christ given to you. The blood of Christ shed for the remission. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Whenever you smile. And I go, oh, that looks good. Bye, Mark.
Happy Mother's Day.
And also with you.
Mm-hmm.